I had perceived by experience how that it was impossible to establish the lay people in any truth, except the scripture were plainly laid before their eyes in their mother tongue, that they might see the process, order, and meaning of the text. William Tyndale, 1530.
Ah, Master Tyndale, you have returned. Did my sons perform well today?
They performed well, Lady Walsh.
Good, good. Every gentleman should learn how to ride, shouldn't he?
Ah, yes. And every gentleman should learn how to read as well.
Ah, you'll be interested in our guest then, Master Tyndale, since you are both a scholar and a churchman.
How is that, my lady?
Well, one is a scholar from Oxford, and the other is a learned priest.
Indeed?
Yes. As you know, my husband, Lord Walsh, he relishes a good debate. He thinks dinner tonight should be rather lively. What do you think?
I think that debates at table cannot be good for one's digestion.
Well, that never seems to affect my husband's. He eats as much as two men. But, thanks be, he hunts enough to keep us all well fed. These supper debates are like the hunt to him. Only here, he provides both hawk and the game.
Which am I to be tonight? Hawk or rabbit?
Oh, hawk, surely. My lord, he is much pleased with your wit, Master Tyndale. Master Tyndale, will my sons make scholars?
They might if they wish to. At present, their interests lie more out of doors than in.
Yes, and I quite agree with that. And as for now, Master Tyndale, if you'll excuse me, I must go see that the boys are dressing for dinner.
Very well.
Good evening, William. I have brought Master Tyson to supper. This is my children's tutor, Master William Tyndale.
Hello.
Ah, Father Benedict. This is Master William Tyndale of our household, and Richard Tyson, both scholars out of Oxford.
I'm honored to be a churchman of your service. My father sent me to Oxford in hopes that I might attach myself to the Holy Mother Church.
To Oxford for that reason?
Yes, one must be well learned to be a servant of the church.
Yes, that is true. And you, Master Tyndale, you have such aspirations as well?
I am content with my position here.
Come, William. Do not be humble on my account. Surely you'd like to be a bishop. Why, a man of your ability might even be a cardinal.
I prefer a quiet study and a humble life.
By that, do you imply, sir, that our cardinal is not a humble man?
I only mean that the cardinal is a public man, and that I would not like such a life.
Think of the luxury. You'll never get fine robes and gold chains in my poor employ.
Cardinal doesn't seek these things.
Whether he seeks them or not, he has them, doesn't he?
He's no more than his due.
Ha! Cardinal Wolsey has more satins and silks than any merchant in all of England.
Yet he is still a worthy servant.
Aye, a better politician. He is second only to King Henry. What do you think, William, of the noted Cardinal Wolsey? Is he worthy or not?
If by worthiness you mean godliness, then we must check his behavior by scripture. There, we are instructed not to lay up for ourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust corrupt, and thieves break through and steal. From what I have heard, I would say that the cardinal would do well to check his wardrobe for moths, his carriage for rust, and his castle for thieves.
How dare you speak of your religious superiors in such a manner?
Oh, he is not the only one. In Germany, I heard of a man named Martin Luther, who brought far bolder accusations against the priest.
And mark my words, he'll burn for it.
Aye, that is certainly possible, if the church can reach him there.
It shall. It is necessary. For he not only speaks against the clergy, but against the Pope himself. And that's not the worst of it. He also seeks to corrupt the scriptures by putting it into the common language.
You say corrupt?
Exactly.
But I have heard that Luther did his translating from the ancient languages, carefully studying the texts in order to preserve its meaning with absolute precision. Did I hear wrong?
No, he was
trying to... Then he did not add to the Word of God, did he?
No.
Nor subtract any part of Scripture?
No.
Well, then if he did not add to or subtract from, I would say that he had preserved God's Word, not corrupted it.
What I mean to say is Luther's translation is totally unnecessary.
Unnecessary?
The common man does not need the scriptures. The Pope will tell him his duty.
And who will tell the Pope?
He's a vicar of Christ and needs no instruction.
He needs the Word of God as much as any man.
It's clear in church doctrine, Master Tyndale, that what the Pope speaks is the Word of God.
Where is that in the scripture?
It is in church doctrine.
I defy any doctrine not founded on the scripture.
Take care. I say your words smell of the flame.
And I say that if God spares my life, before long, every plowboy in England will know more of the scripture than you do.
During the days of William Tyndale, the scriptures were relegated to only the popes, cardinals, and bishops, or whoever else the Mother Church deemed necessary to have them. Therefore, the ordinary man did not have access to God's Word.
Master Points, how is business with you?
Well enough, I suppose. That is, when the dear church keeps her hands off my goods and out of my pockets.
Peace, good sir. Your words will burn us both.
She has a point, Thomas.
Take care who you run up against, sir.
Your pardon. There are so many to watch out for in this great city.
Perhaps you might say there are too many in this city who think themselves great.
And who are...
Could either of you good men tell me where I might find Bishop Tunstall?
And what would you have to do with Bishop Tunstall?
Perhaps he seeks some holy man, since he has failed to find one on the streets.
Why, you...
I have a letter of introduction and a request.
The bishop's house is there.
Thank you. And thank you.
Ah, Thomas. Thomas Poins.
Phillips? I thought I left you in Antwerp.
So you did, but I am here now and looking for a way back.
You are a hard man to keep up with. At any rate, before I go back to Antwerp, I must make my way to Germany.
That suits me. I am in no great hurry.
That is good, for I will be here a month or two.
Till later, then.
Yes.
Who is that man?
Ah, a mere vagabond, but diverting company.
You know, Thomas, I have noted that every time you come to London, your stay seems considerably shorter.
That is because every time I step ashore, I find things worse than when I left them. I tell you truly, Monmouth, it is so bad that before I board my ship, I stand upon the docks and make sure every tariff clerk's eye is fixed on me. And then I stomp my foot with the greatest vigor.
Oh, to show your disapproval for their feet.
That is only part of it. Right? I also stomp so that they see my clean boots, so they don't charge me for the English dirt I carry off.
Well, before you clean your boots too well, I should stop by your house this evening for some English venison.
I would be delighted, but why not come now down with me to the docks?
Ah, no. You see, I must stay behind to see the grand procession.
Oh, I forgot that is today.
Indeed.
If I am fortunate, I may yet have time to miss it.
Make haste.
Sir, what is this ado? Is the cardinal indeed coming?
You see, greater than the cardinal, my good sir. You see, the cardinal's hat is coming.
His hat?
Indeed, his very hat. Wolsey's wool, the merchant's fleece.
But why all this procession just for a hat?
Why? Well, because, stranger, we took the relic too lightly when it came before. We have another chance to show our due respect.
To his hat? This is strange.
Indeed. But tell me, stranger, where are you from that you should know so little of London's marvelous processions?
I come from Gloucester, to see the Bishop Tunstall on an urgent matter.
Well, you'll not see him today. You see, he must greet the hat.
Oh, but he will see me. And when he does, he cannot fail to see the urgency of my proposal. You see, I desire to translate the scriptures into English, but I cannot without the bishop's sanction.
Bishop Tunstall's sanction?
I have friends, the Walshes, who gave me a letter of introduction. They hear that the bishop is a good man.
Well, perhaps they know a different Bishop Tunstall. But pardon me, where are my manners? I am Henry Monmouth.
And I am William Tyndale.
Well, then, Master Tyndale, should the bishop delay your proposal for any reason, I am at your service. This evening, I will be dining at the home of one Thomas Poyntz. His is the large one past the docks. Ask anyone to direct you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
That was a meal fit for a king.
No, my friend, I say if the king came here, he should get no more than porridge.
And I'd say it'd be more than he deserved.
Yeah, I'd agree. But I do think that we should keep our opinions somewhat private.
What I said in the streets this morning.
Indeed.
I knew you'd get around to that.
Thank you.
But, Henry, I'll only tolerate your scoldings if you put some fire behind it. I grow so weary of polite English scathing.
Fire is precisely what I had in mind. And if I am to burn, I prefer it to be for something that I have said, not for something that you have said.
Come, Henry. Not even an English king would burn you for this loud Dutchman's antics.
Maybe not for your antics, but quite possibly for me knowing of your illegal cargo.
Luther's books, you mean.
Indeed.
I tell you truly, Monmouth, it does my heart good to bring them here. As I'm sure it did your heart good to read the one that I gave you.
Oh, it did.
Luther, he is a good man. Mm-hmm. Much like you, but not so polite.
You see, that's also what worries me. You see, it is the good men who are condemned.
Only in England. And I have come to the conclusion it is because of that strutting peacock, Cardinal Wolsey. He is a fool!
Speaking of the cardinal, I notice that you are unable to escape the grand procession for his hat. You should have stayed by me. I met a most interesting man.
Did you really? A whole man or just his hat?
A whole man, I believe.
Well, what sort of man? A merchant?
You might say that of him. You see, he comes to England to trade a most unusual ware.
Aye. And what is that?
His English translation of the scripture. You see, he has come to London to seek Bishop Tunstall's sanction to translate the Bible into English.
You indeed met a whole man today, Henry. But Bishop Tunstall, he'll have none of this man's translation.
I thought as much, Thomas. And so I told the man, William Tyndale was his name, that he should come to me if he should find himself in need of aid. Indeed, I hope he may be joining us yet this evening.
Splendid. If you stick with me, I shall cure you of your cautious English ways.
Or better, I shall teach you how to be a cautious Dutchman in England.
We shall compromise.
Fair enough.
And I say that we shall see the Master Tyndale before long, for he is but a button on the Cardinal Wolsey's cap. Come, come, all ye pompous, excuse me, pious monks.
Yes.
Come and view the dainty relic.
Well, at least they had only the hat to carry around the street, and not the cardinal.
Dear sir, we seek to humble our monks, not to kill them.
Yes.
Oh, it's right through here.
Pardon us. Master Tyndale. Sorry, pardon us. I'm so glad you decided to join us. This is my friend Thomas Poyntz of Antwerp.
Master Tyndale.
Hello.
I had just finished telling him of you, and I believe you two have a great deal in common.
Henry tells me you are here to see the bishop.
I am indeed. I have just received a letter granting me an interview.
Nothing good will come of that.
However, it is good to seek help through the proper channels.
And what are you proposing to the bishop?
An English Bible.
I tell you straight out that the king will not allow the English people to have the Bible in their own language.
However, if Tyndale can convince the bishop...
No, the bishop will have him burned at the stake.
Gentlemen, I know the danger. But I also know that God meant for every man to have access to his word. The milkmaid and the plowboy, as well as the bishops and the cardinals. An English Bible is the only way. With or without permission, I will finish this translation. My Lord Tunstall.
Master...
Tyndale. William Tyndale.
Ah, yes.
As you know, my lord, I have come concerning a most urgent matter. I assume that a man of your stature would have little time and would want me to come quickly to my point.
You assumed correctly. Proceed.
Sir, I feel called by Almighty God into translation work.
If, Master Tyndale, you are called by God, I would think that would suffice. Why do you come to me?
Indeed, his call is sufficient. But there is the matter of this Oxford document. I know that it is only a formality, but it is stated there that I must be in the presence of a bishop if I am to translate the scriptures.
The scriptures? But this you sent me is not the scriptures.
Oh, no, that is only to assure you that I am able to translate.
Master Tyndale, I am a bishop.
And thus concerned for the people.
And I am interested in scholarship.
I knew that too. That is why I did not hesitate to come to you. I knew that you would be reasonable. Well, more reasonable than those silly monks in the surrounding towns who hide themselves in rich men's chapels.
Silly monks?
I beg your pardon if that seems harsh. But it is true. There are some, my lord, who wear religious garb but know nothing of the scripture. And when you present it to them plainly, they rage and call you a heretic.
Indeed?
Quite so. I have even sat at a table with one of late who became so overwrought that he declared that the Pope's word was above the word of God.
And what did you reply?
Though my words were hot, my head was clear. And I assert to you, though in a kindlier tone, what I said to him. The people need the scripture. That is why I seek position in your house.
My house is full.
But a bit of bread and a place to stay is all that I require. And I would not ask even that if I did not need your permission to continue.
You have my permission to translate.
Then I ask no more.
Just not the scripture.
But if I can't translate the scripture...
At least not now. I'm sure a man of your abilities shall have no difficulty finding a post in London. And who knows, there may come a time in the future where the climate is more seasonable for your endeavors.
The seasons are not to be considered when God's will is to be done.
Master Tyndale, I am your religious superior, am I not?
You are.
And as you have said, I am to care for the people.
I have so said.
Then take some kindly advice from me. Mark the times. Seek to woo rather than war with your superiors. Seek to learn before you propose to teach. And above all, take time to see the value in your pearls before you cast them to the swine. Good day.
Good day.
And now my latest visitor.
Enter!
Ah, my lord, I have never seen such a fine display of taste. Fine, yet discreet.
Do not weary me, Tyson. My time is valuable.
I am sorry, sir.
You know this scholar, William Tyndale?
I have met him only once, sir. I am not of his.
You need not squirm. I simply have an errand for you.
Anything, my lord, for your grace.
Or for money?
My lord, I am always at the service of the Holy Mother Church. If I can assist in apprehending this heretic,
You call Tyndale a heretic? That is a bold accusation.
He is a bold heretic, my lord.
What proof have you?
I have heard his conversation. He has scorned our monks.
There are those who deserve scorn.
He has even scoffed at the great Cardinal Wolsey.
And so have many others.
He even defies church doctrine.
What know you of church doctrine?
I have studied, sir.
Indeed. Then may I ask, why you did not apprehend this heretic yourself? Why did you not take him in hand, bring him unto me, and, in your bold and learned way, refute his arguments?
I did not think to do so, my lord.
No, I would not imagine that you would.
My lord, I am only trying
Put your feeble mind at rest. I have seen the Master Tyndale, and I have discovered that he is zealous. A zealous man is never prudent. Inevitably, he will be ensnared. Even now, he is headed for the net. But I need more evidence. That is why I sent for you. Follow him, but mark me. Do not let him know that he is watched.
Yes, my lord.
Phillips. Come on, come on.
My ship is ready to sail. Where is William?
Oh, I sent my servant for him.
Have you told him of the danger?
Oh, there was no time. I had only time to grab a few of his personal belongings. When he arrives, I have only to persuade him to go with you.
All right.
Where is Phillips? Was he not to meet you here?
He was, but that is nothing. What the man swears to do one day, he discards the next. I shall not wait for him any longer.
No.
It is too important that I get William away from here now.
Indeed. Here he comes.
Henry, wait. What is it?
Oh,
what has happened?
It is good that you've come so quickly.
We have heard the rumors in the streets.
But that is common.
These rumors pertain to you.
That, too, is becoming common. My sermons
No. It's your translation work.
You are in grave danger, and you must sail with me now.
Gentlemen, this is my home. I read an English Bible in the
hopes that... But it cannot be done in England.
William, you are a learned and good man, but many are not as you. See, Tunstall is this...
Tunstall is politically cautious, but he will eventually yield to his conscience.
No, Tunstall has no conscience.
See, many clergymen are serpents in religious garb, for in such costume they may cloak their craftiness.
I have dealt with crafty priests before.
None with a sting like Tunstall's.
He is an opportunist, and I assure you, he awaits to strike one who will best serve his purpose.
Then he may never strike at all.
But he is already coiled.
The whole of London is a den of vipers. Mm. My crew has been threatened. One man has been accosted. I have to sail immediately.
William, for your life, for the work that is your life, go to Germany. Speak.
Come, we have no more time.
William, take this for printing expenses.
Henry, I'll be back. Be careful.
Godspeed.
There are certain sons of iniquity in this city who distribute Lutheran books in great number. They are trying to infect the land with heresy. The Catholic faith may perish utterly unless good men rise up and meet the danger. Luther is a child of the devil, full of detestable heresies. He seeks to overturn the Pope and the teachings of the Church. Some of his followers are in this city, preaching in the very pulpits of our churches.
Take hold of yourselves, good people. Is it indeed heresy to preach the word of God?
Go forward then to this holy work and win for yourself an immortal name.
But wait, how can you
arrest this man?
On what charges? What have I done?
I give you license to defend the Catholic faith.
Your Grace, Bishop Tunstall.
What do you want?
The scholar, he is gone.
Well?
On a ship, my grace. I've lost him.
But I have not.
Sir?
You did not think I would leave so great a matter in your hands only? Fool. Well, get a ship and follow him.
Yes, my lord.
because of the persecution of Bishop Tunstall, Master William Tyndale was forced to flee to Germany. Here, in the back room of a small print shop, William Tyndale continued his translation work of the scriptures.
And when they saw him afar off, before he came at them, they took counsel against him for to slay him, and said one to another, "Behold, this dreamer cometh. Come now, and let us slay him, and cast him into some pit, and let us see that some wicked beast hath devoured him, and let us see what his dreams will come to."
And you, William, what will your dreams come to? You may want to reconsider, for you as well may be slain and cast into some pit. I hardly think...
If you do not believe in our work, why do you stay here?
You asked me to look after William, did you not? If I did not distract him from time to time, he would never leave this study. You don't want the scholar to starve, do you?
Friends, please. More and more you are at each other's throats. Come, I am grateful to you both for making my work here easier. But now I must finish the Old Testament, and I cannot, if you insist, on making my study a meeting place for quarrelers.
William, this is a splendid translation. I am honored to carry it on my ship.
You will sell them as cheaply as you can, will you not?
I will. Although the English people are willing to pay any price, some have offered me whole wagon loads of goods just to be able to have one of these books for a few hours.
But if you sell them too cheaply, we will not be able to print more.
But you cannot put a price on such words as these. And ye shall be brought up before rulers and kings for my sake, as a testimonial unto them. And the Bible must first be published among all nations. William, there are two printing errors in here.
There are many such errors, I fear, Thomas.
I am sorry, sir. It could not be helped.
Oh, friend, I meant no blame to you or your men. No one could have done so much at night, all the while expecting King Henry's men to throw open the door with torches to burn you out. In truth, I did not think that they would follow me across the sea to gain their vengeance.
Still, the errors trouble you, do they not, William?
Our Lord deserves the best.
God understands your heart, William. He also understands that your king seeks your life and forces you to flee from city to city. God sees these precious books, and he counts it your best.
Perhaps. Yet, I would wish to send flawless copies of God's word to England.
God's word will not come back to him void. You have so said. Have faith.
Perhaps when these are sold, we can print better copies.
Not without more money.
I am the merchant. I will deal with the money.
But Thomas, please do not take any more money from Monmouth, no matter how he urges it upon you. His generosity to me is the only charge Tunstall can bring against him. You have said that that alone keeps him in the tower.
True. But how did Tunstall know of our private transactions? I mean to know, but until I do, William, translate. And you, sir, keep the presses inked. And we will
eventually... And we will leave the provision for this work to the Almighty.
We may not need to. Or rather, the Almighty may have already interceded on your behalf.
How so?
It seems King Henry has a quarrel with Rome.
I have never known a monarch who has not at some time quarreled with Rome. Pride breeds contention.
But this quarrel touches upon the male heir to the throne.
What heir?
Precisely the point. Since he has no heir, King Henry would rid himself of good Queen Catherine by divorce.
Divorce? Then his quarrel is with a higher power than the potentate of Rome.
That may be. Nevertheless, rumor says that he is soon to wed Anne Boleyn.
This has nothing to do with my work.
Ah, but it does, for you see, King Henry proposes to establish his own church. To please the clergy, his new church will follow the doctrines of Rome. To please dissenters as well, however, he speaks of writing a new English Bible. It is a compromise.
Spoken like a true Englishman.
And you believe this?
Kings change, and when they do, laws change also.
And change, and change, and change.
Come, Poyntz. You simply do not want our friend to return to England.
Exactly. I will never trust the life of my friend to the whims of the English court.
Let us back to work, gentlemen, and leave the whisperings of court for more profitable labor.
Off! Hands off, you scab!
Not until I have my money.
Here, what is the meaning of this?
This dog burst into my shop, took my vintage, did not pay.
Such vintage is not worth pay.
Get a hold of yourself, Phillips.
What about my money?
Woe unto the man that giveth his neighbor drink. Here, that is more than you deserve.
If you don't mind me saying, you should seek better company.
Phillips, you are drunk.
Drunk? Yes, I believe I am.
John, I do not understand you. When Thomas is away, you are the only friend I have in this strange country. It grieves me to watch you slowly kill yourself with dissolute living.
How do you live in this dungeon, this hole, and work without reward?
I will get you something decent to drink. I do not work without reward. And what you call a dungeon, I call a comfortable study.
Of course. When I look at something, it looks sordid, filthy. But whatever you cast your gaze upon becomes pleasant.
That is because you only see with this world's eyes, John.
There is no other world. Does my bold speech startle you? You say I am drunk. That is so. But even when I am drunk, I am certain that this about us is all there is. We are trapped in this cage of human flesh, and there is no escape, William. And though we hang upon the bars and cry until we can cry no longer, there's no man to free us.
You pity yourself too much, John. I too have felt the torments of your prison. So has every man who would be honest with himself. But Christ has freed me, and he would free you as well if you would but believe the scripture. It is here, John. Here. Let one who loves you more than I shed light into your prison.
One day, perhaps.
I want to help.
I know. And your generosity is, at times, the greatest burden I have to bear.
Enter.
Master Tyndale?
I am he. This is John Phillips.
Good afternoon. I am Stephen Vaughn, emissary for His Majesty King Henry VIII. Thank you for seeing me.
Sit down, Master Vaughn. I do say that I already had reservations, but
as an Englishman, and a loyal one, I could not refuse you.
I come peaceably, sir, I assure you.
What does the king want of me?
His Majesty desires to have you home.
Why?
He has read what you have to say about the practice of the prelates. Your wit and logic fit you well to be a court scholar.
I can hardly see William in court.
Because of my writings, you say. But I have done nothing but castigate the king's favorites. I have called Tunstall a horse leech. I have called Cardinal Wolsey a vile wolf. And the Pope, I declared, was an antichrist. I am invited back to England on these merits?
Oh, he cares nothing for your railings. He only cares for the advantage your wit will lend his new religious controversy.
I see. But, Master Vaughn, surely you would agree that even if the king and I had some of the same religious enemies, it would not necessarily mean that we were on the same side.
You should find the king's religion comfortable, Master Tyndale.
Only if it is poorly furnished like this study.
John, your wine speaks where you would not.
Sir, you could ably defend the king's new church with your keen pen.
I have no time for political games.
It is no game. The king is in earnest.
Then what says he of my translating? Has he accepted the idea of an English Bible for the people?
Not at present.
Then he would change only the head of church, not the heart. There's no more to say.
But there is. Be reasonable. I'm empowered to offer you a large sum of money and a fine home.
You waste your time.
Surely. A man of your intelligence can see the advantages of living under a king's protection. A fugitive's life is no life at all, is it?
By my translation of the scriptures, I have transgressed the king's desires even before I enter his protection. Where is the logic, sir?
Yet, but one more reason. I have good evidence that your life is endangered here.
I thank you for the news.
His life means nothing to him, but threaten his Bibles.
Oh, those are past threats.
What do you mean?
All of the English New Testaments were burned this fortnight past in front of St. Dunstan's.
All of them?
As I understand, Bishop Tunstall ordered it.
But how could Tunstall get all of the Bibles?
He must have had logical help.
Silence oft preserves a drunken man, Phillips.
It must have been points. You know it to be true. Who but the merchant?
Be still.
It was the merchant who sold the book, sir.
It is no matter how it was done. It is done.
Reconsider my offer. I will be 3 days in this city. Send word if you will leave with me.
I cannot, as I have said.
Will nothing move you?
Not to England.
As you say, I am done.
Good day, Master Vaughn.
Are you sure Poins is on that ship?
His letter said he would be here tonight.
And the letter mentioned nothing of the burning of the Bibles?
You know that it did not.
Poins is a sly devil.
You will not accuse him without proof.
But how can you blindly agree to stay with him to Antwerp until you know?
When I have given my trust to a man, I do not withdraw it until there can be no doubt that he has betrayed me. Call me a fool, John, but I would do the same for you.
William, my good man, I hope you are as well as I.
I am well.
Thank God be praised.
What of the books we sent to England?
They were sold.
Did you get the price you wanted?
I did, and more.
So we have heard.
What we have heard, Thomas, is that all the Bibles have been burned.
That is so.
But what happened? Why did you not tell me?
When I arrived, Tunstall's men were everywhere. They were determined to get the Bibles, William, it would have been the people who suffered. Suffered after they had sold all they had to possess the scripture.
You wanted proof?
Burn the scripture? Burn the word of God? And you, Thomas, I trusted you.
You do me wrong, William. Did you not say that we need money for better printing? Then I say, let Tunstall pay for it.
You mean this?
That is the money that the good Bishop Tunstall paid me for the Bibles with the printing errors. Take it, William. Take it and print more and better copies of God's word.
It is as the scriptures say. Even the wrath of men shall praise him. Good friend, I owe you an apology.
I should say.
You are sly as a fox.
As some would say, a serpent.
Will not the English king soon aid William's translation of the Bible? From what the merchants in this house say, the English people clamor for the king to show his church is different from the Pope's.
My good wife, you are too logical and practical to be king.
How so?
Henry Tudor will indeed be forced to appease all his subjects, but some of these subjects are Catholic. If he uses Tyndale's Bible, he'll be called a Lutheran. So he must please all the people, however, so the path he chooses will be more indirect.
All this for a new wife, Mistress Anne Boleyn. Perhaps the Bibles could be published without William's name attached to them.
There is a sympathetic noble in Henry's court who knows a man by the name of Coverdale. It may be possible to get the Bibles printed under his name. William, you were back early today.
Yes, I came back early to meet John Phillips.
I do not mean to pry, William, but you know that Thomas has grown to distrust that man greatly, and I have grown over the years to trust my husband.
Yes. Thomas has shared his opinions with me, but men like John, well, it is such men who need our help most.
You will excuse me then. The day wanes and I am behind it.
I am sorry to intrude upon your household, but it seems this is where my friend is being held captive.
This is a merchant's house, not a prison, sir. Any who do not like it are free to leave.
Points in a gown, wouldn't you say? I have come to take William to supper.
Supper is served here. You are welcome to join us, however.
You are kind, but the conversation I have with our friend is rather personal.
It is important to you, then?
Yes, it is.
Very well.
About the money you lent me, I cannot repay it just now.
Oh, no matter. Is anything else troubling you?
I have many concerns.
I want to help.
You have already done... Nah, it is nothing. Come, let us go to supper.
Very well.
Tyndale! William Tyndale! You're to come with me.
What is this? Phillips! Go to Thomas! John?
Tyson, where have you been? Spending my money? I am not a man to be kept waiting.
Just a man to be kept.
I work for kings, for governors.
Kings? Petty clergymen, rather.
What I do for Tunstall is none of your affair. You are nothing but a paltry messenger. Or have you forgotten that I am the one they send into the houses? You they hide in the alleys. As for the scholar, you had as much to do with that as I.
At least I had religious reasons for wanting him stopped.
You swine! Don't speak to me of religion like that! You want favor. Now give me my money and we'll both get what we want.
I do not have your money!
What do you mean?
There is no money!
Where is it? What have you done with it?
I never had it!
Don't give me riddles, man. What are you saying?
Tunstall will not risk the king's disfavor.
What?
With Henry's religious controversy, every bishop fears for his position, even for his life. Tunstall has decided he wants no connections that the king may one day question.
You lie!
Kill me now, Phillips! There's no profit in it!
Someone will pay.
No. You have been used.
the only man who was ever kind to me. Dear God, what have I done?
Master Tyndale, you have received a letter.
Ah, yes. From Thomas Points.
Your friend. He seeks your release.
God be praised.
Then you are free then.
Far better, Peter. My manuscripts are already in the printer's hands.
King Henry consented to publish your Bible?
He has no notion that it is mine. It is to be published under another's name.
But it is not his translation.
Yes, but Coverdale has great influence. He has convinced the king that his position as head of the church rests upon his willingness to give the scripture to the people. And Henry, my dear friend Henry Monmouth, has been freed from the tower.
But what of you? If something is not done soon, you shall be burned at the stake.
Peter, look at me. If the politicians do not kill me, the coming winter surely will.
Sir, I have tried to provide for your needs. I have even sent for warmer clothes.
Friend, I did not mean to grieve you. Only to assure you that I am not loath to die. There is, however, one small favor to ask.
Anything.
When I am finished with the letter I will write, get it to Thomas.
It is done.
I write to you with a lighter heart than I have had for months. The news of the publication of the scripture was as water to my thirsty soul. As Paul, I believe that the time of my departure is at hand. I am ready to be offered, yea willing. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. And there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me in that day, and not to me only,
but to all those that love his appearing. My dear friends, do not mourn. The wrath of men is but praise to God.
Come, Thomas. If we mourn, it is only for ourselves. The church has claimed another martyr, but heaven has gained a saint. Up, and let us be about the work that God has given us. William would have it so, for I do not doubt that he will ask us when he sees us again. Does every plowboy know the scripture?
On October 6, 1536, William Tyndale was tried and convicted of heresy and treason. Because of his religious beliefs, William Tyndale was strangled and his body was burned at the stake. It has been said that Tyndale's last words before his death were, "Lord, open the King of England's eyes."